Então, boa tarde. Hoje teremos a apresentação da professora, desculpe, da pesquisadora doutora Marielle Gosset, que é pesquisadora do Instituto IRD de Toulouse. Ela, sua especialidade, né, já faz 15 anos. Trabalha com imagens de satélite e radar baseado em sol, especialmente na questão das medidas de precipitação. Seu foco nos grandes extremos hidrológicos, né, enchentes e na variabilidade de precipitação de uma forma geral, né, no, e do balanço também hídrico. Atualmente, né, ela trabalha com treinamentos e também pesquisa na África e também aqui no Brasil. No momento, ela está com a posição de pesquisadora visitante na FUNSEMI, e também é membro do time de cientistas da NASA. Do convênio NASA-CNES, no âmbito do satélite SWOT, e faz parte também do GPM da NASA, que é o Global Precipitation Measurement. Então, a doutora Marielle Gosset, com grande satisfação, que a gente recebe aqui no Departamento de Física, né, uma palestra sobre a questão das medidas de precipitação, né, e seus impactos que diz respeito ao balanço hídrico, né, e previsão também de extremos, né, hidrológicos. Com a palavra, doutor.
Okay. Bom dia a todas. Obrigada, professor, para a apresentação. Como dizia, eu sou pesquisadora no IRD, mas agora sou em Fortaleza para trabalhar com a FUNSEMI. Cheguei no Brasil faz 2 meses e não falo português muito. Muito bem, para apresentar em português. E então vou apresentar em inglês, mas as slides são em francês e as questões podem ser em português. Ok, agora vou poner a apresentação. Ok. E penso que agora você vê minha apresentação?
Sim, professor, estamos vendo perfeitamente a apresentação. Pode
Ok.
continuar.
Agora em inglês. Desculpe.
Sem problema.
So I'm going to talk about, as Professor Afuano said, about rainfall monitoring. Especially, I've been very interested in rainfall in the tropics. Because in the tropics, rainfall is very important and also it's very challenging because it varies a lot. And I will talk about some of the work I've been doing using classical remote sensing like a satellite, weather radar. And now I'm working on some more opportunistic measurements of rainfall using the telecommunication network. So first, what are the issues in rainfall monitoring, especially in the tropics? One thing is that rainfall is extremely variable, so it's difficult to capture it. We will see that remote sensing, classical remote sensing, radar and satellite is very interesting, but there are some limits. And I think that opportunity measurement is definitely part of the future of the Earth and water observation, and we can discuss that a bit further. So first I will talk about rainfall and why is it so difficult to measure and why is it so important. So rainfall is a variable. It's a flux which comes toward the Earth. And depending on what is your perspective on precipitation and what is your specialty, your physical specialty, or if you're just a citizen, you may be interested in rainfall at different scales. The one which is the most used is looking at precipitation in a kind of climatological scale. And there you have maps like that. So this is a map of an interannual composite of precipitation over the globe. Well, in fact, here it's over the tropics. It's from July to September. And we can see that in that season, rainfall is mainly north of the equator. And of course, there are part of the tropics where it's raining more than others. Okay. But what we see here, which is like several months of precipitation, is the result of individual rainfall systems. And those occur, they are very localized, they are extremely three-dimensional. And inside those rainy systems, what's happening is some very complicated processes with microphysics. And in order to understand the map which is on the top left, we need to understand what's happening here at the microphysics scale, which is maybe we are talking about particles which are sometimes less than a millimeter. So this is one of the challenge of remote sensing. So one of the consequences of the way precipitation work and on the way those physical processes inside the clouds happen is that rainfall is extremely variable at all scales, from intercontinental, interannual scales to micro scale. And this is true horizontally. So in general, when we are us human, we tend to live on the Earth, and we are very sensitive to the variability of precipitation in the horizontal position. Sometimes it's raining in Fortaleza and it's not raining a few kilometers away. But most of the variability actually is in the vertical direction. And this is extremely important for remote sensing and for estimation of precipitation, because with remote sensing, we are going to have access at some information which is higher up in the cloud and not really at the rainfall at the ground, which we are interested in. So that's why it's a challenge. We are going to have to observe something which is very variable. We are going to observe it somewhere up there in the atmosphere. And from there, we want to deduce an information which is at the bottom there, on the surface. And the problem we have also, which is very visible here, is that sometimes it rains here, but not a few kilometers away. And if our observing system missed this rainfall here, then we don't have a good estimation inside the water basin, for example. Another interesting feature of precipitation is what we call intermittence. In fact, most of the time and in most of the places on Earth, it is not raining. So rainfall is a very intermittent phenomenon. And for example, in some areas in the tropics where I've worked in Africa, most of the rainfall accumulation for a year occurs in only a few hours, if you put it all together. So we need to be there observing within those few hours, otherwise we don't have a good estimation. So that's the challenge. Variability. Now, why are we so interested in measuring rainfall? Because it's very difficult, so we could say, well, forget it. Rainfall is interesting because it's the main entry to the hydrological cycle, to the continental hydrological cycle. And we are very interested in this cycle, the water cycle. And we want also to know how this water cycle is evolving, for example, with climate change. And another reason why we are very interested in precipitation is for something you guys in Sahara know very well, is that when there isn't enough rainfall, we have drought. On the other end, when there is too much rainfall, all of a sudden we have floods. And sometime in the same year and in the same place, we can have drought and then floods. So it's a real problem. Okay, so how do we monitor rainfall? How do we monitor the extreme events in particular in the world? What are the solutions which have been implemented? So one solution which is used a lot in Europe, in US, and a bit in Brazil, but is not yet so developed in Brazil in an operational way, is weather radars. Okay, weather radars are very interesting. They transmit microwave in the atmosphere, and then they receive echoes. And with this system, you can have map. This is an example of a rain map over France, for example. So France is a small country. It's about 500 by 500 kilometers. And just to cover France, we have 30 weather radars. So it's a lot of instrumentation. So why is weather radar so interesting? It's because with a radar, you have this 3D scan capability. And I told you already that precipitation and clouds were extremely 3D. It's a very 3D phenomenon. It's varying in all directions. So being able to explore that in all directions, a bit like a scanner for the human body, is extremely interesting, and we learn a lot of things by this kind of radar analysis. We rightly understand the processes. So how does it work? Well, I'm not going to go back very much into the details, but the idea is that the radar, which is here, transmit radio waves, and then when it encounters clouds or precipitation, some of the energy is coming back. And if also the waves we are transmitting, some of them are polarized in a horizontal plane and some of them are polarized in a vertical plane, then we learn all sorts of interesting information about the shapes of all these hydrometeors inside the clouds and precipitation. So it's a very interesting instrument. So one of the things the radar is exploiting is the fact that water drops, so raindrops, when they go down, when they fall, they tend to acquire this funny shape here. They are not, when they are very small, they are round, and when they become big, because of the pressure forces they suffer when they fall, they acquire this funny oblate shape. And that's very interesting, because if we have a polarized radar, then what we receive in the horizontal channel is going to be different from what we receive in the vertical channel. And that will tell us how oblate the particles are, and then how intense rainfall is. So this kind of radar, in addition with polarization, has been extremely useful for diagnosing what's happening inside clouds and precipitation. Okay, so with the radar, we have an information on a volume of rain, and to transform that into an information we are interested in, which is usually rainfall, then we have to use some physical property of rainfall, which is to do with the distribution of sizes of the drops. I'm not going to get into these details, but if there are questions or if people is interested in knowing more about that, we can discuss it further later. So with a polarimetric radar, what's happening is that we have maps, radar maps. So if you look at the FUNSEME site, for example, you see those rain maps. But the Funsemi radar at the moment are not polarimetric, so you have only one map. With a polarimetric radar, you have several maps. One is energy in the horizontal polarization, energy in the vertical polarization, and then you can do some ratio, or you can analyze some funny phase propagation effects. And with all these variables, what is interesting is that, how do we exploit that? We exploit that by the fact that different type of what we call hydrometeors, which mean small drops, big drops, hail or snow, they are going to have a different signature in the space of polarimetric variable. So I'm not going to be going to the details of the of this plot, but this is, for example, it shows that hail is going to have a very intense reflectivity, but not very much polarimetric signature, because hailstorms, the hailstones are very round, okay? On the other hand, snow is going to have a small reflectivity signature, because snow is mainly made of ice and air, but it's going to be to have a very intense polarimetric signature, because snowflakes are a bit funny, they have funny shapes. So on this principle, you can have your radar exploring a storm, and you can deduce in different places of the image what sort of particle you think you have. And that's an example of some work I've been doing in Africa, where we had a radar, and we also had an instrumented airplane. And the instrumented airplane was flying in the storm, taking samples. And then we could compare the samples taken by the airplane and the kind of particle we had classified using our radar. Okay, so I'm not going to get into the details here, but this kind of study is very interesting. With a radar, you get a lot of information. And this is, for example, a vertical slice of inside a storm. Okay, so there was a storm, and someone with a radar, a storm like that, did a vertical slice inside the storm. And with this kind of image particle classification, they determined that inside the storm, there was a hail storm, and that could be dangerous, etc., etc. So this illustrates the tool number one to study precipitation systems, and that's weather radar. So is this instrument absolutely perfect? Well, yes, in some ways, but there is a big problem with weather radars, is that they are extremely expensive. The minimum price to acquire just one radar is €1 million, and that's a relatively cheap radar. And you need a lot of money also to maintain it, because it's a very high-tech instrument. And you know, you need also, because it's a very sophisticated and high-tech instrument, you need teams of people who are specialized in microwave and interpreting radar data. And in the end, every year, it costs about the tenth of the initial price. So if you want to have a network of weather radar over a country, it's very expensive. So what are the other solutions? Another solution is using satellite, because satellite is also an interesting source of information. So here we see, you can see here the contour of West Africa. As Professor Fragno said it earlier on, I've been working a lot in Africa. And we are in the heart of the rainy season. And this is an infrared image taken by Meteosat. And what we see over several days, we see the propagation of these objects. And what are these objects? These objects are rainstorm. So you can see something which is very interesting about satellite, and you can see it in any satellite image. It's that it really can see and show how the clouds are moving. And if there is an organized structure in the clouds, like organized convection, storms, you can really see them, and you can see them be born, get bigger, propagate, and then die. So it's a very interesting tool for analyzing precipitation. And this is an example of some tool we've developed to automatically track this system and check them individually and look at their trajectory. So how does it work though? Because we said we were interested in rainfall, and rainfall is on the ground. And with a satellite, what we see is actually clouds and cloud movement. So of course, one problem is how can we connect this information here on the cloud on to what we are interested in, which is the rainfall here. And that is a bit complicated. So for example, the infrared information, which is on the geostationary satellites, we just saw an example, it gives us some information about the height of the top of the clouds. And the more convective a cloud is, the more likely it has rainfall. But this is only a statistical link. It's not a very precise link, and we cannot say that every, for example, here, I think it might be raining, but I'm not totally sure, okay? I just know that it's likely to rain because there is a lot of high clouds. So there is another type of satellites, which is very interesting. It's the orbiting satellites. So they are lower. They work in higher frequency. They work in the microwave spectrum. And those satellites, some are passive, some are active. They are interesting because they are sensitive to the emission and to the diffusion of the microwave, which is emitted from the Earth, but which interacts with the hydrometeor inside the clouds. So early on, we've seen precipitation system as a radar can see them. We saw that there are different kinds of particles. There is rain, there is snow, there could be hail. And those different kinds of particles are going to provide a different signature in the microwave spectrum. So what we do to estimate rainfall from satellite is that we combine this information from the microwave satellites with the other information from the geostationary satellites. At the moment, we are extremely lucky. And here we can see two things. So here we have the GPM constellation of microwave satellites. And here we have a GOES image of infrared information. So here we see, if we look at the bottom picture here, we see that it's things are happening very fast. We have information every 5 minutes. And what we see is cloud dynamics. Here we are with the microwave sensors. There are much less of them. We have in a given place, we have information every 3 hours, something like that. But we can see that there is much more here, much more texture in the images, and we have access to some information which is close to rainfall. So a lot of algorithms have been developed to combine this kind of information and this kind of information to estimate rainfall. So I'm not going to go into too much details about this. This is a work from one of my PhD students, and he wanted to check if we use the satellite information, are we as good as the radar, which I showed you earlier. So to study this problem, he's been doing some wavelet decomposition of the signal, and to analyze one sort of space and time frequency the radar can see in the rainfall, and the satellite can see in the rainfall. And to summarize that very quickly, because I don't want to get too much into details, what we see is that if we look at rainfall with a radar, we see that there is a lot of information in, here we are a quarter of an hour, so 15 minutes, 2 kilometers, there is a lot of variability. But the satellite is not able to see that very precise rainfall variability. So it's working, but there is still some work to do. And if we are interested in rainfall at scales of 2 hours or something like that, and less than 20 kilometers, which is, for example, very interesting for surveying extreme and for flood prediction, satellite is not quite enough at the moment. So what can we do? And this is the last and third topic I want to discuss with you. There is another kind of information on rainfall, which we were not thinking of it initially. And this is information which we can get from the telecommunication network. So that's very interesting. This is a mobile telecommunication mast of antennas. This network work in the microwave. They propagate wave between these antennas, which propagate the mobile signal. The signal is in the microwave domain. And we've seen with radar and we've seen with satellite that microwave is a very good frequency to detect rainfall. So the idea was started to develop to use those microwave links, so-called commercial microwave links, which come from the mobile network. So you have quite a lot in Fortaleza, I've noticed. What's happening is that between one antenna like that and the next one, the signal which is propagating is in the microwave domain. And if there is rainfall between the two antennas, then the signal is going to be attenuated. So if we have a good relationship with the mobile telephone operator, maybe we can have access to the data and we can use their network for rainfall monitoring. And when we see, for example, the density of this kind of antennas in a city like Fortaleza, we can see that this is very, very interesting potentially. So here is an example of some work we've been doing testing this methodology in Africa. We are here in Ouagadougou, in Burkina Faso. And here we have an example of the transmitted power by one of these antennas. The received power at the other end, and from there we deduce the attenuation due to rain. There is other source of attenuation, but when there is rain, there is a very marked peak, and this is a pretty unambiguous signature of rainfall. So using this data, which could be free for the scientist and for the agencies. Using this signal, we should be able to estimate rainfall. So we've been doing this kind of things in Africa for a while now, working in Burkina Faso in particular. We had several papers where we proved that it really works, and we had quite a lot of media coverage because Africa is a place where there is a very, very big shortage of precipitation data. So it really seemed like a good idea to try to use the telecommunication network, which is very dense, which is growing every minute, to do something for the environment with it. So this is another example of some research I have developed with the French operator Orange, which has a lot of, which is working in a lot of countries in Africa, and here we are in Niger. So the country Niger is here, and here is the river Niger, and every year in this area. So the gray, kind of grayish area here is the city of Niamey, the capital of Niger. And all those lines, all those red lines or blue lines, they are individual pairs of telecom antennas, okay? And why are we interested in working in Niamey? It's because, oops, in Niamey every year there is flooding. And so it's interesting to see if we can understand what's going on and maybe predict it using a better rainfall measurement. So how does it work? This is an example of the data we've been exploiting in Niamey. So for each pairs of antennas like that from the telecommunication network, Orange is providing us with some raw information. And we can see here every 15 minutes, we have some information on the transmitted power, some information on the received power. And here, for example, we can see the received power was pretty stable, and all of a sudden we have a big drop of power, and that's exactly attenuation by rain. And this is an example of some comparison we've done between estimating rainfall from a link, so from between a pair of antennas, and compare it with the rain gauge we had in near the antenna. And we can see in black and blue, there is a very good consistency between the two measurements. And we've done that now for several years with different leaks, analyzing the correlation, doing some statistics, and clearly it works. We have some very high correlation, and we can definitely see that this telecommunication network could be used as additional information to complement satellite and radar. And of course, one advantage is that the network here is already there. It's provided by the operator. So the only thing which is needed is data. So this is some example of some app we developed. So we are still over the city of Niamey, and that's the links, the microwave links we exploit. And we are looking at the storm crossing the city, and every 15 minutes we have a different map. And for example, we can see that here the storm is intensifying because we are going from zero, which is kind of gray, to some blue or green, which is some higher rainfall. And we can, what is interesting is that we can localize the intense rainfall inside the city. The city is only 10 by 10 kilometers, it's pretty small, but we can look at the variability inside the city, and we can do that every 15 minutes. And at the moment, the data is free. And this is some other examples. Here we are in Cameroon, which is a big country. And here the network we are provided is all over the country. We can see, of course, that it's very, very much denser when we are in the cities, because of course, in the cities, there is a lot of population, so there is a lot of customers, and so there is a lot of antennas. But at the moment, we are testing the methodology in real time in Cameroon, and over the country, we have more than 1,000 links. So it's typically Cameroon is an example of a country where you hardly have any information on rainfall. And in order to put things back in perspective to what we've been discussing before, which is the satellite, here we compare a map, instantaneous rainfall map, which we've deduced from this network of links, with a satellite rainfall map from the NASA GPM constellation. And we can see the similarities between the two. The patterns are localized in the same place. The intense rainfall is seen in the same place. We can see also that there is a complementarity, and it will be very interesting to develop a rainfall product using this information and the information from satellite. In fact, this topic is one of the topics I want to develop in FONSEME. And this is some more examples of the app we have in Cameroon, in the city of Yaoundé and Douala, which is the capital. And this is an example in 2008 where we are looking at a storm which is propagating over the city, and we can analyze the data 15 minutes by 15 minutes. So, for example, if we had this kind of information in Brazil and in Ceará, it would be extremely interesting to compare this kind of information with the radar from FONSEME, for example. And so that's one of the questions which I came here to investigate is, could we do something similar in Brazil and especially in Ceará? And this is just an example of all the antennas, all the microwave links you have in Ceará, if you take all the operators. So there is definitely some potential there. The only thing is to find a good collaboration with the operator to make this prospect and this potential a reality. So in fact, we started working in South America on this technique, but so far it's been in Uruguay with a colleague from Uruguay who could have information from the, because in Uruguay they have a national, a state telecom company, and they agreed to share data with a scientist. And here is an example of some links which have been equipped in Uruguay. In yellow, there are several gauges. And a student of mine started analyzing and comparing the rainfall measured by the yellow gauges and the rainfall deduced from the microwave link, like we've done in Africa. And we can see it's working pretty well also. So. Okay, so I think I've more or less went through the different things I wanted to present to you today and discuss. There are, once again, to summarize, there are many ways to measure rainfall. Satellite, of course, is extremely interesting. Weather radar is super interesting, but expensive, so you cannot really multiply them. And what we call opportunity measurement from telecom network is a newcomer, is a new player in this game, and it will be definitely very interesting to develop this kind of application also in Brazil. What is interesting to know is that the way the telecom networks are evolving is also good for the use of the data in meteorology because of the needs with 5G, etc. They tend to increase the frequency they use, and higher frequency are more sensitive to rainfall. So there is more potential there. And we can say that it's a green solution to answer some of the needs of hydroclimatic risk. It's green because we are recycling data and information which is already there, for telecommunication application. It's a very open field of research. I showed you some of the things I've been doing. There is a community of people who are working on this, but there is all sort of new research which could be done. For example, about how to merge this data with other kind of data. I have a student now who is working on that, how to merge radar, satellite, and telecommunication antennas. There is a lot of question about how do you interpolate between the links, how artificial intelligence can be used to process the data, etc., etc. There is a lot of research which is still open. It's a pretty new field of research, but because there is a bad, at the moment we haven't really managed to find a long-term and secure agreement with the operator for them to provide the data. In Africa, I showed you some example. They are providing us the data, but it's on a research basis, even if it's real-time data. They are not actually committed to have a guarantee of service because they say, okay, what's the business model? Okay. Okay, and well, this idea of using opportunistic data for environment, it's something which is a bit of a new trend in science. For example, we know that there is example now of people who are developing flood monitoring system based on individual mobile phone and image analysis. There is also some people who've developed something to measure rainfall, to measure if a screen is wet or not, and they use the screen knows when there is a drop on it. I know that also there is a lot of research in France which is being developed about the use of the future cars, which will be very connected and use all these sensors the car have for meteorological application. For example, nowadays, one example is if the windscreen wiper is on, then it means it's raining. So if you have this information from a lot of cars and the cars are connected, then you can know that it's raining somewhere. And we are, in fact, at the moment we are, I showed you in the first slides that in France we were using radars, and there is a network of 30 radars in France. And despite that, there are still some problems of quality, especially in mountainous area like the Alps or the Pyrenees. And in fact, we are at the moment developing some tests with Météo France to see how the telecommunication network could help make the estimation of rainfall over France, despite all the radars, better. So I think that's it. And that's it for my slideshow. I think I'm going to stop sharing the screen. And I'll be very happy to reply to any questions. Thank you very much for your attention. Obrigada.
Estou vendo que há grande número de ouvintes. Isso é muito bom. Palestras sobre meteorologia são raras, muito raras no nosso departamento. Agradecemos especialmente a participação do professor Soares, professor Carmona, nossos estudantes, bolsistas também. E aí, pessoal, vocês... eu, particularmente, eu sou meio suspeito de falar, porque... essas são as coisas que eu amo, né, de fazer pesquisa, eu adoro, sempre gostei disso. Achei formidável, né, essa ideia de usar, genial, né, como se diz em francês, genial, de usar uma rede de comunicação, né, de telemóveis, é impressionante. Então, passo agora a palavra para os colegas. Acredito que para que haja, né, algum debate. Ninguém? O pessoal está online mesmo?
Até o momento, nenhuma pergunta, professor. Mas se vocês quiserem continuar debatendo algum ponto da pesquisa da professora, enquanto a gente pode dar mais... O professor Paulo de Tarso acabou de postar uma pergunta. Eu vou colocar na tela, ok?
Tá ótimo. Então... Doutora Gossê, a senhora consegue ler em português, não é? A senhora está lendo a pergunta?
Sim. Entendi, mas vou responder, vou responder em inglês, ok? Yes, in fact, I at the moment I have a PhD student who just started on this topic of how can we mix the geostationary satellite, the satellite, the orbiting satellite, and the antennas. Because the problem of the antennas is that we saw it a bit on the image I showed in Cameroon. It's not very regular, it's extremely heterogeneous. There is a lot of antennas in the cities, but there is not very many antennas in the countryside. So it's a challenge. So one of the things we would like to see is how we can maybe train locally the satellite data with the links, where we have links, and then use the trained algorithm to convert rainfall in the places where we don't have the links. Also, there is one thing which I didn't say, is that the links are very good for intense precipitation. When it's raining a lot, the links are very good. But when it's not raining too much, there are other sorts of fluctuations. And so there is a complementarity also, because the links are very good for extreme rainfall. And some of the other instrumentation, like the satellite, might be better for lower rainfall. So there is also a combination in type of the type of rainfall we can measure. Ah. Okay. Claro.
Acho que a gente deveria ler a pergunta em voz alta, professor Afrânio, porque pode ter gente também que está somente ouvindo, né? Então, eu vou ler aqui a pergunta do Francisco Geraldo de Melo Pinheiro. Deixa eu ver aqui. Na verdade, a pergunta dele começa aqui. Bom dia, professora. Você já tem acesso aos sinais das torres em Fortaleza?
So, infelizmente, não. When I came here about a year ago, and with people from FUNSEME and also people from GETEL, UFC, we try to discuss with operators like Claro, Vivo, Oi, but unfortunately we don't have data, and I would love to, and if anyone can help, that would be great.
Temos também a pergunta do professor Carmona. Thanks so much for the presentation, professor Gosset. Do you know the status of the two satellites in Ceará?
I guess you mean the two type of satellites, the infrared over geostationary and the microwave. In fact, Ceará is a good region because you have two geostationary satellites here. You have the GOES and you have the Meteosat. And I know that at FUNSEME they are working pretty hard on using this satellite information. One of my objectives here is to work with them on assessing a bit better how good rainfall measurement can be in Ceará. I know that there are some problems because some of the rainfall here, the satellite works very well when there is a very intense convection, and when the convection is very high. But here, sometimes you have clouds which are not so high, warm rain, which is fed by the warm water from the sea, and the satellite doesn't see very well this kind of rainfall. So that's one of the challenges I want to work on with the people from FUNSEME and anyone from university who wants to work on this, of course.
Uhum. O Wagner okay. Rodrigues de Sena pergunta se há alguma técnica de machine learning usada para analisar os dados coletados pelas diferentes fontes e assim desenvolver um modelo de previsão?
Uhum. Ok. This is a very, very interesting question. In fact, we started last year, a student started working on this, but then because of COVID, it was a bit complicated, so she stopped. But this is definitely an area of research which I think it would be very, very nice to develop. I think there is a lot which can be done, and especially in the places where we have the links, we could train the satellite on the link using machine learning. And I'm sure we would get some very interesting information. So yes, yes, I would really love to develop that while I'm here in Ceará. And if you're interested, let's do it.
Professor Carmona retorna com a pergunta: have you ever applied any kind of rainfall inference based on Ceará radars?
Yes, yeah, so in fact, I mentioned I have a PhD student who started working on this. So what he started doing was comparing the radar data from Ceará with a satellite. But we haven't yet compared the radar data from Ceará with rain gauge. And I think it would be very interesting to do. Because what we saw with the student was there was a big difference between the satellite and the radar. So we assume the radar is better, but we not have it compared with a gauge yet. And that's another topic. If some students are interested to work on this, they are totally welcome.
Acredito que encerramos as perguntas aqui. Nós temos algumas pessoas agradecendo.
Eu gostaria de colocar as perguntas, pode ser, Germano?
Sim, claro, professor. À vontade. Vou só colocando aqui os agradecimentos, tá? Mas o senhor pode ir perguntando.
Tá ok. Certo. Obrigada a todas e a próxima palestra será...
Doutora, queria fazer só as perguntinhas. Existe alguma diferença notável do sinal daqui dos celulares, da rede de celulares nossas aqui em Fortaleza, em relação aos da África, por exemplo? Ou seja, a frequência é melhor, a distribuição é mais densa?
A coisa é... Yeah, the thing is that even in Africa, we had a frequency which go from 80 gigahertz to 7 gigahertz. So there is... Everywhere there is a big variety of frequency and length, and in the same country, two operators can have different type of network. One difference is from discussing with Oi last time I came, is that in Brazil they are starting to put optical fiber cable to replace some of the antennas. So then we are losing some information. But at the same time, with the 5G needs, they're going to have more and more antennas for some short local links. So I think there is hope. We just need data.
Essa dificuldade que a senhora conseguiu os dados, né, desses operadores daqui, se deve ao quê? Questões de privacidade, algo desse tipo, segurança?
Poder repetir devagar?
A senhora mencionou que até agora não recebeu os dados dos operadores, não é, para fazer o trabalho, não é isso? É, a que se deve essa falta de cooperação, digamos, a questões de privacidade, alguma coisa na lei, de telecomunicações?
Não sei. Por exemplo, junto com gente de CEMADEM, we tried to discuss with the people from Claro, and initially they were very interested, and then nothing happened. It seemed that the technical people are very interested, but then it's difficult to have the authorization. I don't know, they seem to be frightened to share the data, even though it's just data and signal, there is nothing private about the data. So it's I don't understand why it's so difficult. One of the things seems to be that they don't really like to give things free. They want money. So if they see something where they don't see where the money is, they don't really want to be involved. Unfortunately, I think that they are driven by economy and nothing else.
A senhora mencionou uma espécie de colaboração de ganho a ganho, ganhão-ganhão. Em que sentido as redes, né, os operadores, iriam ganhar com esse tipo de colaboração? A não ser a venda, né, do sinal.
Sim. É difícil. É muito mais difícil que o que pensava antes. Even with Orange, I mean, we've been working with them for 5 years now. And they are very happy to give data for research. But then when we say, okay, now let's save it in real time for the weather service in Africa, they say, oh yeah, but that's going to be expensive. How much are we getting? So I think that one possibility is that with 5G, they are going to have an increased frequency, and they are going to become more and more sensitive to rainfall. So they might start to be interested in collaborating to understand a bit better their own vulnerability to rainfall, and they might be interested to have prediction. So that could be a way to have a win-win collaboration with them. Say, okay, you give data, and we help you know better what the impact of rain is going to be on your network.
Temos mais uma pergunta aqui, professor, do Matheus Brandão, vou colocar na tela. Os modelos de previsão, como o SMWF, têm muita dificuldade de fazer previsão para a região Nordeste. Isso deveria ser devido a alguma deficiência nos dados de radar?
I think it's more... the thing is, to predict rainfall over Nordeste, what you need is not especially the radar map over Nordeste. You need information which comes from further away. So yes, if there was a very good radar network over the whole of Brazil, it would probably help. Then the problem is over the ocean. A lot of systems come from the ocean. Over the ocean, you don't have the radar anyway. So, but it's a very good question. There is more information is better for prediction. And it's true that the radar network in Brazil is not to the level of the radar network in Europe or in the US. It's clear.
Acredito que no chat aqui no momento, professor Afrânio, nós não temos mais nenhuma pergunta, mas se o senhor quiser ainda dar sequência, sem problema, viu?
Não, estou satisfeito com as perguntas que eu fiz, com as respostas da doutora Rossê. Agradeço a contribuição dos colegas, dos estudantes. Matheus Brandão é um dos estudantes que tem feito essas pesquisas sobre ilhas de calor aqui, doutora. Né? Ele é muito interessado em meteorologia, é um fanático, entende muita coisa aí sobre previsão. Acho que ele vai estar muito interessado em conversar com a senhora e prosseguir seus estudos nessa área. Então é isso, eu agradeço demais, doutora, a sua participação. Admirei bastante seu trabalho, né? Agora que conheci com mais detalhes. Realmente foi uma ideia genial, não é? Essa de usar a rede de celulares, né? Realmente nunca havia pensado nisso, mas muito legal mesmo. Infelizmente, né, a gente está vendo essas dificuldades aí, por questões comerciais mesmo, né, como a senhora colocou. Bem, então é isso. Se a senhora quiser dizer alguma outra palavra, algumas palavras finais. Gostaríamos de vê-la novamente aqui, né? Já que a senhora falou que promove treinamento também na África, né? Por que não fazer um treinamento conosco? Nós temos estudantes que com certeza estariam interessados, inclusive eu, o Helis professor. Então, deixo a senhora para fazer algumas palavras finais, por favor.
Sou obrigada muito pela oportunidade. E se tem possibilidade de colaboração sobre tópicos, como a questão de inteligência artificial, ter exercício para estudantes e tudo, eu sou aqui para colaborar.
Vamos esperar o lockdown terminar, mas a gente pode trabalhar online.
Sim. Seria então melhor.
Germano, fica com você agora, meu querido.
Certo. Obrigado. Muito obrigado, professora Marielle, obrigado, professor Afrânio, e obrigado a todos. E até a próxima.
Tchau, tchau.
Tchau, professor. Obrigado.
Tchau.